All right. This morning, I played... Did I lose something here? This morning, I played some Hard Reset Redux, which is a very old-school flavored shooter. I paused and I left, came back, and I've got a loading screen. It was interesting. All right. So, last I remember, I had a big fight at the beginning of a new mission, or a new level, and I wasn't sure where I was going next. So, this says, track down and kill the professor. So I need to follow him to his hideout. I don't know where his hideout is. And I think I jumped over this to get into this area. It was a one-way street, so this must be an okay place for me to be. Place up there that I think I can't get to. Oh, wait, there's a big arrow. What does that mean? That means something? Nope. Nope, it doesn't. Oh, that's true. My camera is obscuring me by. Thank you, Cloudcraft. Let me see. There. I think I'm better there. And here's a place. Oh, activate this forklift. Oh, look at that, a button. Nice. Okay. Here we go. Oh, there's a hole in the floor. Oh. I so frequently enter areas and have little guys skitter off. Chase this wire down. So comments I made in the game this morning include... Whoa! Include the fact this game has no objective markers. It's trying very hard to reflect kind of old school game design values. And so there's no objective markers. Ah, yikes. Nope, go away. And instead they rely on level design cues like this wire on the ground to guide you through the world. Everything explodes! Much like Doom, there's no reloading in this game, which is, it's really, actually, after just playing the crap out of the new Doom reboot, it feels weirdly familiar now. It felt really weird in Doom to not be reloading, but now that this is the second game like that I've played, it actually feels completely normal. And oh, what's that? Oh, it's you. Let's paralyze you with my special unlockable ability. I can't do it immediately again. I'm not actually sure. What? Oh, is it on? Is it that orange bar on the left? That's telling me when I can fire my flechettes. I'm not sure. Anyway, yeah, you don't reload, and you've only got so you've got two weapons at any given time. You've got your bullet weapon and your energy weapon, but both of them can be upgraded and changed into different weapons. So at any one time in the heat of combat, you've got two choices. But long term, you've actually got a lot more than that. Funny, the pickups that I pull up after these guys die. I miss them completely with my flechettes. The pieces they drop actually look kind of like parts of their bodies. Like, they did a pretty good job of sort of, like, thematically matching the pickups and the enemies so that they look like they could actually have dropped out of them a little bit. Guy's kind of creepy. Yeah, so I started with a machine gun and I upgraded it to this shotgun. I don't get a lot of feedback. So when an enemy dies, and obviously when an enemy explodes, I get a ton of feedback for it. But... unsuccessful shots. I have trouble even telling that I hit the guy. See, so It's so funny because, you know, how good it feels to use an attack in a game generally, it's less about the animation. I mean, the animation of the attack and the effects associated with the attack are important, but it's the impact on the target, generally, in my opinion, is more important. And so in this case, they made some interesting choices where, you know, when I kill an enemy, no effect. When I kill an enemy, there's a big dramatic effect. Explosions, bodies flying everywhere. But when I shoot them and I did not kill them yet, there's almost no impact at all. And I can't even tell anything happened. It's not the way I would prefer it, but, you know, that's definitely an interesting choice they made. You definitely tell the difference between enemies that are taken out of the battle, enemies that are not. So that clear difference can be helpful. Though in some cases too, the fact that these enemies are inorganic robots, when their dead bodies are just sort of bouncing around on the ground with physics, sometimes that actually is hard to distinguish from the enemies themselves that are up and walking around. Okay, so I restored energy. Energy barrier control panels operational. That thing down there, is that what I'm talking about? Oh, what the? Hey. Nice. Oh, it looks like there is lots of talking going on in the chat, and I am missing most of it. Cloudcraft says you noticed an overheating animation on my gun, and I missed that. I didn't see that was happening, so I'll have to keep my eye out for that. Yeah, Lycabat suggests that, you know, that's one of the good things about, say, Call of Duty does with the hit markers on when you shoot. Just to give you just that little bit of feedback so you know you're doing the right thing. In Doom, when you land a blow that is effective, your blood comes out of the enemy. And when you land one that's ineffective, you get this little purple ripple on the enemy. And there's a really kind of clear difference on the target between a successful hit and an unsuccessful. Because some of the enemies are armored and they completely ignore attacks from the front or attacks that aren't headshots. Or what are you? Did they just accidentally hit that thing that killed them all? Oh, and Lycobat points out something, yeah, that we noticed this morning with the crosshair. The fact that the crosshair is always red is tough because there's so many games where the crosshair is only red when it's over an enemy. So I'll frequently think I'm hovering over an enemy because my crosshair is red, and I just read a red crosshair as... Of course, right now it's blue, so apparently they're using red and blue on the crosshair to distinguish between which gun I have out. But, you know, which gun I have out is actually one of the more obvious things on the screen. I don't think that actually needed much of a HUD difference to make it work. But it's interesting because this game is deliberately going old school. It's like, it's billing itself as, hey, you guys remember old school shooters? This is an old school shooter. It'll make you happy if that's what you like. That's sort of the way this game sells itself, but I don't think that means that they can ignore the conventions of modern games. Like, they could, you know, I can say, you know, you could consciously, I want to get that. You can consciously decide to use older conventions that are familiar, just to use older conventions, that makes sense, you know. Things like not reloading your gun, which is, you know, the thing they do here. But you still have to sort of... Your game still exists in a context, you know. There's still other games that exist outside of your game that players will be playing in between sessions of your game and before your game. And so you have to bear that in mind. So, like, things like a red crosshair means a certain thing now in modern shooters. And even if this game is not building itself as a modern shooter, it kind of has to keep that in mind. So, I don't know. I mean, I feel like they still could have used crosshair color to mean something different. It's just red specifically has got such a strong association already. It's hard to escape the meaning that it sort of has for me unconsciously, you know? Oh, Lycobat just made a suggestion for the area I left that I might never go back to. So if I ever come back there, yeah, I will try sprint jumping and seeing if that actually makes a difference to whether I can get that pickup or not. Oh, I didn't even see that thing. That's very useful. Oh, the sheer amount of chaos in this game is amazing. And like I say, the amount of feedback you get for a successful hit can be very effective. So even though there are times in this game where I wish... Oh, what? Oh, hi. Where I wish I was getting more feedback for certain actions, when they decide they're going to do a lot of feedback, man, do they take that seriously. I think I might need some more consistent damage here. Alright. Now what am I doing? Okay, that's green. Now let's see if I can afford an upgrade. So here's a weird thing that I don't quite understand. I don't know why I can't get this. Is it just I need to unlock these things in order? What is a viper? Oh, it's an electric mortar. Interesting. You know, I kind of liked the mortar-like attack. Ah, whoops. Oh, okay, so the orange bar on the left, that's what's earning me these upgrades. So now I fire mortars. Interesting. Okay, cool. Actually, this is the direction I'm supposed to be going anyway. Let me see what's its alt fire.
Welcome to upgrade terminal.
Stasis grenade. So okay, so let's see here. Area effect increased. So I don't know if I need the stasis grenade because I got the flechettes, but maybe that means I can move on to something else with the other gun. So now that's the only two upgrades I had.
Good job. You got past the energy barrier. You were getting close. Push on, Major.
Hey, X-Rogan. Cloudcraft wonders if I can charge this to launch further. Nope, that is the range at which I can launch that. It costs 15 ammo. That's another store. And what's down here? Cash money! It's down here. So yeah, I wouldn't want this as my exclusive weapon, but... seems like I can, I can sort of set up the battlefield the way I want with that thing, and then switch to my shotgun. Yeah. Whoa. With the sheer number of enemies that pop out, it kind of reminds me of Painkiller a little bit. Did I stick it to him? think I did. Well, that's really effective against large creatures. And by creatures, I mean robots. Yeah, Chronotosis, my verdict so far is that this is indeed a fun game. But, oh, I wonder if I can even hit these guys with this mortar. Oh, obviously not if I shoot like that. Nope. And I'm not liking what's happening there. Okay, so I think I might need to switch back to my plasma shooty thing. There we go. That's more effective. Whoa, what is... What's shooting me? What's this one? Alright, they're being pretty generous with the pickups and stuff. I can imagine that. Yeah, I'm playing on normal difficulty right now. I'm betting that they kind of tuned the game expecting, you know, real players to play it on hard. I'm having a pretty different experience right now. I'm not sure where I'm... Oh, hello? Well, I've got the advantage of cover. There we go. So is this actually where I want to go, or is this just where the enemies are coming from? Oh, cash money! Things are so sparkly. Okay, so, okay, I think the red crosshair and the blue crosshair, again, they're also tied to the ammo colors, which makes sense. Just, even if it had just been, like, orange and blue or something, it wouldn't give me the red thing, you know? Guys are pretty tough. Ow. Oh, hello. Whoa. Okay. Zoom last checkpoint. I wonder where that was. Chronotosis is like, I'm buying this game right now. Cloudcraft, this is not quite... I don't know if you'd call it an arena shooter specifically. It is definitely a game where you frequently need to kill everything to progress. You can't just... can't just sort of run past the enemies and have that work. Okay, I've just got one. Let me see if I can get some health back. Health back, health back, health back. Wow, running is fast. Ah, whoa, he's still hitting me with things. Unlock this guy as hard as I can. Oh crap, nope, don't do that. Oh, and the car blew up. Oh, so close. Lycobat asks, how do you feel about people playing easier modes that weren't really intended by the developer? So I think if an easy mode exists in the game, it was intended by the developer. I think they had some sense that, you know, Really, when people put easy modes in a game, a lot of it is about just trying to extend your audience. You know, making it clear, this is where we think, you know, this is what we tuned for. But if you want to enjoy, you know, the story of our game, if you want to enjoy, you know, the aesthetics of our game, but you don't have the time or commitment or just the skill, you know, if you're not an experienced gamer, you're still welcome to enjoy the aspects of the game that, you know, that you can.
Some people, especially as gamers age, physically just aren't up for the hard modes in certain games.
Yeah.
There's just, they can't do it anymore. And for some games, it's like, no, that's what the game is.
Yeah.
Other games where it's like, there's a lot to see in this game and a lot of fun stuff to do.
Yeah. Welcome, Ian, everyone, by the way. Now someone will actually read your stuff.
Yes.
I've been doing surprisingly well at this moment at paying attention to people's comments in the chat. Normally I'm just useless. But one comment that I've been making is that this game does not necessarily
So like a bat taking a very hardline stance saying, I think you're completely missing the point myself. If Dark Souls was easy, nobody would care about it.
So again, as I said, I think it varies a lot based on the game. Dark Souls is a game very much about mechanics and struggle. I don't agree that your first example, The Last of Us, is. I think there are plenty of people who would just as soon be like, no, I never want to play a fight twice in The Last of Us. I don't care.
But they're still getting a legit Last of Us experience.
I want to get the story. I want to move through this environment. I want to do the emotional arc. And I don't care if I was not fast enough turning to shoot that guy. That's not why I'm playing this game. And that's that is a valid way to play The Last of Us.
Yeah, like I went on a campaign a couple years ago to get my sister and her husband exposed to a lot of games. He's an independent filmmaker, and he really wanted to understand games because he felt like a lot of his audience was, you know, their lives were informed by games and he hadn't really played them for most of his life. And so they got a PS3, and I just basically sent them a bunch of, you know, just sent them a new PS3 game every month. And their favorite stuff was the Naughty Dog, Uncharted and everything. But one of the games I also sent them was Mass Effect. And Mass Effect 3 had that mode where combat is just stupid easy. Because it's just about the story. Because there's this, you know, this overarching game that you play in Mass Effect, which isn't about combat or your prowess in battle.
Right,
it's all about
the adventure and the sights and jumping over things and exploring and fighting
and making
stuff.
Moral choices and seeing those reflected in the story and that stuff. And like, I thought they would enjoy all of that stuff, but be put off by the fighting. And so I was like, hey, use super easy mode. You know, you can have the parts of the game that you want, and I think that's totally fine. I mean, there's no such thing as like a movie that you can't progress in, because you weren't good enough as a movie. Now there are movies that you probably can't understand unless you're good enough at understanding movies, but that's sort of a different kind of expertise requirement. You at least can see all of the images and over time come to understand what you saw. And games, there's some games that really rely on the achievement being an important part of it, but others that really don't.
Yeah, I mean, there are books. I am one of the first people to argue. No, there are absolutely books that are too hard for some people.
You know what? House of Leaves. I quit because the difficulty level was too high.
Anything by James Joyce. You pick up Finnegan's Wake and it starts mid-sentence.
But at the same time, you can read all the words and get to the ending. You might just hate it because you're not understanding anything you're doing.
It's true. I think a lot of people haven't really gotten through it at that point and give up or get stuck. But I
will give you a chance to become one. So Leak Code says they only play games on easy because they just don't have the time. And there's a lot of times where I'm kind of tempted to do the same thing. I mean, you see, you know, just watching this Twitch stream, I'm on this mad rush to play as many games as I possibly can. And there's some games where I definitely, like, I think, oh, I might really enjoy the harder difficulty of this, but I'm not going to play it because I want to see more of the game.
Sure. Cloudcraft is calling out, he only takes issue with games that there's no ability to make them hard enough to satisfy the sense of achievement. So I think, like a bat, what you might not be grokking here is that there are very different reasons that different people play games. For you, challenge is obviously a huge part of why you play games, and you don't understand
why someone would even enjoy a game if they're not being challenged. Yeah.
But there are a whole lot of people for whom challenge is totally, if not not even secondary, but tertiary. It is in the way of the fact that what they want to do is see a cool environment and explore and find things. There's a lot of people who are into games basically to see the next art asset.
and games for whom it's participatory theater, you know, it's like they're playing through a story and a cinematic experience, and they get to be one of the actors, and that feels really good. And that's and I feel like, you know, as a game developer, I want to potentially provide for a lot of different experiences within a game. Now, with State of Decay, for instance, there's no such thing as a version of State of Decay without permadeath, for instance. And there's some people for whom permadeath is kind of is almost a deal breaker. Or maybe an entire deal breaker.
And there absolutely are people for whom it's a deal breaker.
And for them, there's probably no version of State of Decay that person is going to be able to really enjoy. But that doesn't mean that, you know, even though that particular thing, you know, that is pretty much intrinsic to State of Decay, there might be other areas in which we can,
there's no way to do the State of Decay experience without that.
The sense of loss.
Taking it out. It's not State of Decay anymore.
But one thing we are doing, though, is that, you know, State of Decay, you know, loss is an important part of it, but the game continues after each loss. And so somebody can play through the game and have those loss experiences, which normally in most games would be a deal breaker and you lose progress, and you just can't progress anymore and there's nothing to see. But in State of Decay, when you face that difficulty, so what that means is the difference between a good player and a bad player is the good player will have fewer deaths, and they'll have a more successful community. And the bad player will have a more tragic story about a community that faced more hardship. But they can both actually still play. It's kind of like the James Joyce thing, where it's like, you know, you can still technically read all of the words and get to the end of the story. And it's just your experience will be different from somebody else's. I think that's legitimate.
Yeah. So again, Chronotosis is talking about how she likes playing games on hard, loves the challenge. It's not fun for her if there's not a challenge there. There are a lot of times with needing to have like adult responsibilities that means games just don't get finished.
Yeah.
Something she's been debating is whether or not she should consider, in some cases, switching to an easier mode so she can get through it and see more of the game.
Yeah.
Like a bat, not shockingly, is arguing better to not finish something and have the possibility of triumph later than instant gratification of caving. Chronotosis is frustrated by the fact that she's not finishing games. Again, one of the great things about games is that people can play them in different ways for different reasons.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, there are few mediums. I mean, so one thing I learned in, humans, what? Oh, sort of. One thing that I was taught in film school is that, that a movie is made four times. I think I've even quoted this in a recent stream. A movie's made four times.
You write one.
Once when it's written, once when it's directed, you know, and it's shot basically. Once when it's edited, and once when it's watched. And the watching is actually one of the more important ones. You know, two people have two very different experiences in the movie based on what they brought to it. That's true of games too, only much more so. Like, not only is it that you're just having a different artistic experience because of your preconceived notions, but you're also but you're also just genuinely different things are happening on the screen based on your choices, right. Which is not true of movies. But if that statement is true about movies on sort of that semi metaphorical level, it's definitely literally true about video games. I love this thing. It usually sticks to the ground, but you can also stick it to people, and they're just a walking damage machine, damaging all the other characters around them.
Nice. Cloudcraft notes that one of the issues with game design is that both by convention and because it's easier, which are definitely related, people tend to gate content behind success rather than modifying what content changing the outcome based on the level of success.
Yeah, that is one of the things where, you know, one of the great opportunities that State of Decay has kind of afforded us is the fact that it does this unusual thing of exactly modifying the story based on your success, not just gating it.
And the reality is, that's something that State of Decay gets to do because that's the kind of game that it is.
Yeah, not everybody can do that, which
I don't think there's a way to do Uncharted 4 where you're not kind of gating things behind success.
Yeah.
There's a really great video the Uncharted guys did about accessibility, specifically talking about the accessibility options in the game.
Yeah.
And making it playable by people with different
disabilities. It seems like colorblind options and different control configurations.
Control configurations that make it so you don't have to use both sticks, because for some people, they've got the ability to do one stick but not two simultaneously. Improved auto-aim for certain things.
No, I'm not. I'm not going to hit this guy. Yes! I hit him!
Nice.
Yeah. By the way, I appreciate that you're dealing with my constant reaction to the gameplay while you're trying to make a philosophical point.
Yeah.
Oh, two of them now? What? Really? There we go.
Leap Code is making an interesting point where he's saying challenge feels worthwhile in puzzle and PvP games. If difficulty just translates to HP damage buff nerf, that doesn't really seem worth it.
Yeah, for me, I feel like one of the laziest things you can do is modulate difficulty by just enemy health. Because you actually can really damage the experience that way. Because a lot of times, there's a certain rhythm to fighting an enemy where it's like, this particular enemy is fun to fight for 10 seconds. And then after 10 seconds, that enemy is no longer fun to fight. They've gotten boring. If you make them last more than 10 seconds, you've sabotaged the player experience.
Right. The fun thing about that enemy is figuring out how to fight them, and once you've done that and you know how, doing it over and over and over again doesn't get more fun.
Yeah, or just doing it continuously, it's like a boss where you've learned the pattern, but now you have to do the pattern 19 times.
Yep. There's a reason a lot of old games had a 3-hit or 6-hit boss pattern, where it's like, okay, 3 to 6 is a good number to prove that, like, yep, you got the pattern.
You definitely are good enough at fighting this boss to get credit for it. And yeah, that was actually why I stopped playing, what was the Inferno? Was it the Inferno? Was it the Dante's Inferno? Yeah, I stopped playing Dungeons Inferno because I got to this one battle where it's like, I know how to fight these guys, I just can't fight them, like, perfectly for 20 solid minutes. And that's what it was going to require in order to get past this section.
Right.
So I was like,
I can stay alive for 10 minutes of fighting these guys, but...
Not 20, so yeah, or whatever. I'm probably exaggerating the amount of time, but it was an intolerable amount of time.
Yeah.
For me, in that particular case. And there are a lot of people who like the game, and I felt bad, too, because I'm a huge fan of the production designer involved in that game. Wayne Douglas Barlow is one of my favorite artists. And that game was actually based on an art book of his that I absolutely love. So I wanted to be able to enjoy more. And actually, I probably should have just backed off the difficulty. But again, but I was feeling, though, that same feeling of... destroy the cells on top. Okay. Same feeling of I think, sort of pride that Lycabat's talking about, the sense of, why would I even bother playing this game if I'm not going to be, the best at it, if I'm not going to face the challenge. I had a little bit of those same feelings that kept me from playing all the way through Dante's Inferno, and I kind of feel bad about that now, because I'm like, I feel like I probably missed out on some artistic elements.
Enemy seems like a good one to stick a explosion.
You are absolutely correct. I was mostly just worried about how I was going to get over... Oh, now I'm all out of this ammo. Actually, those stationary enemies would have been good, too. I am not playing as well as I could. I'm mostly... Ah! Ah! Everything is on fire! What's going on? All right. You are absolutely correct that this is probably a good idea. I'm not sure if it's actually hitting... you just stop that.
Definitely.
It is. It is definitely hitting them. I think I just need to get them all close enough.
Yeah, we can kill that back end.
So it looks like the damage is not actually being done by those arcs. It looks like the damage is being done in an area effect, and the arcs are just there to provide a visual for it, which I think is great. There's a lot of games where I've made that same choice, where it's like, let's make sure that the thing that's supposed to happen is actually happening every single time, and then let the visual follow what happens instead of letting the visual thing be the actual effect.
Yeah. Lead Code mentions, I thought the three-hit trope was more about bit space, three hits equals four states equals two bits.
Whoa! I don't even know what killed me there.
I could see that being the case in some NES games. Usually you had enough memory, like, you could devote a byte and have a whole lot more states than two in your memory. You know, you have Mega Man games where enemies have full-on health bars. I don't know enough about the 6502 chip that the NES uses to know if memory management at the level of using two bits rather than a byte is something that will matter.
Yeah.
It will be. I know people I could ask. Next time I'm on stream, maybe I'll bring it up.
Like a bat, I think that it's very well possible that at that age, at that time when Dante's Inferno came out, that I might have been disappointed in myself. In fact, that's probably preemptively why I made the choice I did, was because I knew that I would be disappointed in myself if I decided, you know, to play it at easier difficulty level. But now, today, I don't think I would. Now, today, I feel confident enough as a game designer that if I decide that a game's difficulty is tuned wrong, not just tuned difficult, but tuned like, this isn't fun to play because of the difficulty level, and somebody's made a mistake, a design mistake, I feel confident enough that I can decide that. I can say, okay, it's legitimate for me to play this at a lower difficulty level because the higher difficulty level was done wrong. So yeah, I don't think I would feel that way today. Though I agree, I probably would have felt that way at the time that I was playing Dante's Inferno.
Chronotosis is talking about the fact that okay, we got a couple things. Chronotosis, you need to go back and beat Classic Mario. What the heck? Seriously. It doesn't even take that long. It's like, if you are good at it. She also mentions that there was a certain boss in Dante's Inferno where she just noped out and stopped playing. The hint to which boss being she's a female and she does not care if there are naked ladies.
So she's the ones that, like, enemies, like, pour out of her nipples, I think.
I didn't play Dante's Inferno, so that's all news to me.
Yes, that was definitely a part of Dante's Inferno. There are things that sort of are interesting in fine art. That you know, like when I enjoyed, you know, the art book by Wayne Douglas Barrow, that, you know, certain kinds of imagery that in a video game feel a little bit more tasteless, which
I see that,
which makes me feel weird, because, you know, I consider what I do to be an art form, right? It seems like the same standards should apply to my work that apply to other people.
Drac notes not having heard of or played Dante's Inferno, feeling like they really missed out.
Yeah, it's basically it's a God of War. It's God of War in Christian mythology instead of in like medieval Christian mythology. When was Dante? Was he medieval or was he Enlightenment?
Isn't Dante Renaissance-y?
Renaissance-y, sort of. Oh yeah, Renaissance. Yeah, that's right between the two. So I was correct in the brackets that I set. Anyway. Dante, yeah, he's like a Renaissance, it's a Renaissance Christianity instead of Greek mythology, but it's basically God of War in every other way.
I apologize for what I'm doing to the lights, folks.
What are you doing to the lights?
I'm trying to get one turned on. There we go. Nope, that one's still off. That's weird. I don't know how to...
Yeah, I think, yeah, all of the, yeah, the lights are set on these, like, presets?
They're very complicated. There's, yeah, like, four or five different buttons and, like, a slider. Chronotosis mentions Catholic being the specific.
Yes, it is, and it's sort of like, but it's like Renaissance Italian Catholic mythology, plus it's been filtered through Wayne Douglas Barlow, who is this, like, famous production designer. He did Pacific Rim. So you think of like the way the enemies and stuff looked in Pacific Rim. That's Wayne Douglas Barlow's style. So it's him designing hell. So it's really interesting. And visually, there's a lot of cool stuff going on there.
There's also happening a bunch of really weird stuff that happened with their marketing team.
Oh, yeah, was it? Oh, I forgot exactly what it was, but I remember, yeah, it was kind
of
weird.
It was a lot of, like, nudge-nudge, wink-wink, like, Seven Deadly Sins themed.
Oh, that's stuff. Right. And so, like, so Lust got really awkward.
Lust got really awkward. There were, like, greed-themed marketing promotions, which were like, no, this is you paying off journalists. And they're like, no, it's like, it's fun, it's a joke. And it's like, no, it's really weird, and you shouldn't have done that. You shouldn't even joke pay off journalists.
Yeah.
And Kronatos just mentions it was Lust that she couldn't handle.
Yeah. There was stuff like on the level of that zombie torso that was the Dead Island guys. Was it Dead Island they were promoting with that like female zombie torso thing,
yes,
like model you could get? And yeah, so it's kind of along those lines where it's like, I know gamers are gonna love this, not having any idea who gamers are these days.
Yep.
And not all gamers are ridiculous, uncouth teenage boys.
I'm trying to remember the Lust promotion. All I remember is that it was creepy, as Chronatosis notes.
Climb this...
And yes, EA's PR department is crazy. Zarnathian talking about the game that you're actually playing, rather than our half hour of... Talk his Inferno chat. Watched comparison videos of this game with the original, and he feels like they downgraded it graphically.
Oh, interesting.
Check out Candyland comparison of it on YouTube if you don't believe.
Climb this footbridge. What? I don't even. How?
There's a thingy that you can interact with below you?
So there's this that I already pressed. There's this that I just. One of these I already just turned. And
then, do you go out from here?
I feel like there's a
leave. Go out of this area and around the side.
That's where I started. That's why I came
right,
over here.
Hit that button.
Oh! That's where the entrance
now
was.
Now you have that stuff.
I think that was always there. I don't think I just created it. I think it was just. I just didn't see it. It didn't help that they had sort of what looked like a step on the side that was incorrect. Is this where I want to be? Yes. You can tell because there was a loading hitch.
I think the same loading hitch.
Wah! So, one of the most frequent sights in this game is walking into a new area and seeing a little dude skitter across the screen. Like, that was serious. It feels like that was the seventh time I've seen that. This game has got its own tropes.
There is affection being expressed for Candyland's comparison videos.
Is Candyland a streamer? I don't think I know Candyland. Are they a YouTube person or a Twitch person?
I don't know
them
either. They're apparently a YouTube person.
Mm-hmm. Some kind of shanty. Oh, look at that. See? Always. I think that's probably there because with whatever scripting tools they had, that was probably the one thing that a level designer could actually just do by themselves without asking an artist or a programmer for help. It's just, well, I can make enemies move.
Right.
So whenever I can, I'm going to try to just add some interest and life to the screen by
I'm gonna play with
moving enemies.
I can't see anything.
Oh, so, yeah, sorry. And we've got... I'm going to have to leave about 5 minutes earlier than usual to get to a meeting. And so we're going to... Yeah, so we've got about 15 minutes left. I think. And then push the button. I'm still trying to. Am I trying to open this? Doesn't look like it's connected to anything. But so these are like weapon gates. Like you can't carry weapons through them. And I love it. In this game, what that means is you can't go through them. Because there's no version of you without weapons. When I first saw one, I was like, oh, I'm going to have to lose my weapons. That'll be interesting. And they're like, nope, that's not how that works. It just means no.
Your character's like, well, I absolutely won't be doing that.
Yes. Ah! I think I can set up a chain reaction with those electric arcs.
Ah, I've got so much more light now.
Do you actually?
Yeah, I can.
Oh, okay, cool. I wasn't paying any attention to what was happening with the lights.
I can read the numbers on my sprues.
So, I never played the original game. I'm having trouble accepting the idea that there was actually a visual downgrade with the Redux, just because I mean there are like factors that can make a difference. Like for instance, I could see, I don't know, maybe for instance on the previous. Was the original hard reset, was it PC only or did it come out on consoles? I'm not sure about that. If it was PC only and now it's coming out on a console, for the first time.
They downgraded some stuff for that.
Yeah, because there's just very specific demands that a console will make on you.
I could also see stuff like sometimes there was a comment about blurry textures, and sometimes blurry textures are actually that texture was always blurry. It's just now that it's higher res, you can see.
Oh yeah.
The actual quality of it.
Yeah, we had that. I think we had that issue with State of Decay, Year One Survival Edition, there actually. We had to redo a bunch of textures and stuff because...
UI textures in particular were ones where we went, oh, that was actually always hard to read.
Yeah. But there were also, like readable items in the environment and stuff like that, where on the original game, yeah, it's like you just... Because the original game never ran, at least on console, never went any better than 720p. But, oh, hey! We're streaming right now, in case that is an issue. We'll be done in about 10 minutes. So we will just pass in the night. Matt Heinegger is here, everyone! And he is staying as off-camera as he would like.
X-Rogan says he does not know what Chad is talking about. Trying my best to follow it, but I also decided I wanted to work on this robot, so I don't know exactly what Chad's talking about.
I'm working on robots too.
Yeah, but
I like that we have something in common.
My robots are going from more pieces to fewer pieces.
These explosions are amazing, by the way. I mean, I had my issues here and there with the feedback for shooting things, but man, when everything blows up in this game, that feels really good. But I guess, it could be that I'm just not sort of the aesthetic connoisseur that a lot of people are, but for me, I don't have any problem with the way this game looks. Whether or not somebody who's very technically proficient at analyzing these things, whether they would find fault with this as a as an upgrade to the previous game, I'm completely happy with it. This looks. I mean, it's running at 60 frames a second. At least it feels like it is, and it's making me completely happy with the kind of game I came here to experience. So
it's also. It's possible, again, I don't know anything about their development, I've never played the previous version of this, that capping things at 1080 for console performance, because that's the highest resolution TVs do, impacted how it looked on PC.
Oh, I can see that, yeah.
But again, I don't know. Chronotos has asked which robot this is. This is the Camphor Amazing from... middle third of the first season of Build Fighters, piloted by Meijin Kawaguchi. The name is a pun because he is the Meijin, or master, and amazing in Japanese. Sounds like a Meijin.
So, early on, we were talking about the game not using crutches like objective markers to get you through the world. Turns out they do when they think it's important. I think that it seems like there are probably places where they got feedback that players were just not understanding what to do. Places where it's like, lift a forklift so that you can jump across these boxes, where somebody would probably get stuck for 15 minutes trying to figure out how to get out of the room.
Right.
And they're like, you know what, the pace of our game is more about running in and fighting and combat, so let's not
just
do
tell
that.
Tell people how to finish this part.
Yeah. So I wonder, though, we were talking about this earlier, I wonder if there's an option to turn off those hints.
No.
Oh yeah, enable hints. So if I want to not have that going on, I can turn that off. And so I think you know, people who want to be more hardcore and figure it out without help, it's a self-selecting smaller group than the people who just want to play the game in easy mode. So it makes sense for them to have the default be hints on, especially for if somebody's going to play through a tutorial, and then
let players
decide to turn it off if they want to. Yeah. Put it. Ah! Who are these idiots? I just think very satisfying with about shooting something with a shotgun and just having it fly back. That was actually one of the things I really appreciated when I was younger with the original Doom, was the fact
how
that
freaking great the shotgun feels.
Yeah, and the fact that it would make people. I don't think. Partly it was the splatter effect on the imps, if you got just a perfect super shotgun blast. But I think a huge part of it was actually the way they would fly back if you shot them. Like the kinetics of it were more important than the gore.
Oh yeah, watching the body fly back.
Yeah, there's a visceral level at which that just feels like violence.
Just now had weight.
Yeah, exactly. Can I? I can destroy all these robots, but I'm stymied by a pile of boxes.
So obviously your guns are designed to break metal, and the boxes are made out of wood. Yes.
Alright, well, I've got some. I feel like there was supposed to be a big fight in here of some kind. This is shaped like a big fight room. I wonder what's going to happen if I come up this way and start poking things. I have to walk over every health pickup that I see. Oh, station locked because bad guys. Oh, they already built that in. Alright. So yeah, I have this weird thing where I walk up every... Even if I know I don't need a certain pickup, I still walk over it. I don't know what my deal is.
It's like the residual need to jump into and through coins in modern Mario games. Where it's like, extra lives have not mattered in these games in over a decade. It's so fine.
What did I just turn on? Opened something. Oh, is that a door down there that I opened? I think I was intended to notice this door opening, but I did not.
Breaking trees is actually a really easy one to answer when you run into trees in a card game. The reason why you cannot break trees is because breaking trees is really, really expensive.
Yeah,
making trees, physics objects that are waiting to get hit is really expensive. Making trees have a memory state that know if they've been hit or not is really expensive. Trees aren't like a box that can just bounce away as a physics object. They need to break.
And the individual branches need to flex.
And so that's, you're getting into all this expensive deformation animation. And it's like, it's one of those things where, like, yeah, they could totally have done breaking trees in whatever game you're playing, but what month and a half of work and other features would you want to give up? Because they're also going to lose perf if they don't cut something else visual or physics-based to break trees. Poles are easy. Poles are a single thing. They go, and they don't. Maybe they bend or something. It's nowhere near the complexity of a tree.
I think my own mortar hurts me. I keep not anticipating that, but I think that's actually the case.
It doesn't seem crazy for your mortar to hurt. It seems kind of reasonable.
So there's a thing back there. I've got a...
Yeah, leaves flying around. Leaves flying around, you could probably get away with it.
Take that, Roomba! Yeah!
So if you've got particles set up, leaves flying around isn't the most expensive part. Memory for the state you left a tree in, even if you want to do a simplified version where the player drives away and you simplify the tree. Like, trees are one of those ones, like bushes. People are like, oh, why can't I just drive through these bushes? It's like because deformable plant geometry is so fucking hard to do without it looking terrible or feeling bad. And doing it means that, like, a bunch of other stuff can't happen. To be able to have that waiting to happen in a game is super expensive.
See, this is the anti-weapon barrier. No weapons allowed. So I am not allowed.
Because you're a weapon.
Oh, nice. Okay, cool. So I can shoot straight through the barrier.
That's cool.
So apparently it's not an anti-bullet barrier. It's just an anti-weapons barrier. I can go down here. I kind of lost track of where I'm going.
Ray was talking about impact and performance of console over PC. Impact is always worse on console than PC for basically everything.
Whoa.
Consoles have, almost without fail, consoles have less memory. They have, if their graphics cards aren't better than the PC, they will be in 2 years. You can run into compatibility stuff sometimes, where having a console means you can write specifically to a specific graphics card.
Did they really just give me a sword for the first time, and then immediately pit me against kamikaze enemies?
Yeah.
Really?
It's not the best.
That doesn't make any sense. Why would you do that?
Give you a sword and then put you against enemies, but the sword makes you feel bad.
Yeah! That was nuts! Why? Somebody over there was like, it's not hard enough.
X-Rogan says everything is always bad on console and PC. So that's not strictly true. Because a lot of times you wind up, if your console is your lead SKU, that's your initial dev environment, you wind up writing performance and everything up to what the console can provide. So the PC experience winds up being pretty much the same because you don't leave stuff up to chance. You build a thing that the console can run really well, and then the PC can also run it really well. But in terms of what's expensive for a developer to develop for, you always get more performance out of PCs and they're always harder to debug for. Because there's the hardware configurations and the variety is way higher, so it's easier to get a thing up and running on one PC, and it's a lot harder to get a thing up and running on all the PCs in the world out there that are going to try and run your game.
Yeah.
So there are absolutely strengths and weaknesses to both platforms from a developer's point of view.
Yeah. And you can often get a console game just running really beautifully just because the hardware is predictable. It's like, because with the PC you have to just have very sort of general solutions, but you know, take something like the PS3, you know, like that, if you could, you know, just use its very specific hardware exactly the way it was intended to, and not have to worry about anything else, you could do amazing stuff with it.
Right. There's a question about wireless controllers slowing things down. That is pretty much a non-issue.
Yeah, if you can detect that, wow, you are amazing, and you should use a special controller.
wireless controllers slowing things down. The speed with which wireless controllers communicate at this point is so, so fast. It's RF over a short range. It's basically light speed, which means in a lot of cases it's actually faster for an RF signal to travel than it is for a signal to travel through copper in a wire. So the odds that wireless is slowing you down is very, very low.
Yeah. And wireless, I mean, it definitely travels much faster than the chemical signals between the neurons in your body. You know, so if something is, you know, if something is slowing you down, it's more you than the controller, more likely. So I'm going to have to, normally would go for another 5 minutes, but I got to quit so I can be prepped for a meeting I've got at 1 o'clock. So, thank you, everyone, for being here. This game is awesome. Chronotosis just went and picked it up as a result of seeing it here. If anybody, if you're into old school games like this, if you got really into the latest, Doom reboot, this game scratches that same itch. It felt really good, and that's my review. I'm having a great time. So, any last words, Ian?
I think that's everything.